praise the living Jesus. You're welcome to another session or another, you know, edition of Treasure Search. Treasure Search is a time where we gather together at RCCG New One Youth Church to, you know, study the Word of God, and you know, it's a Bible study session where, you know, we just gather together online to hear what God has for us. Pray that even as you join us today, God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's say a word of prayer before we start. Our Father and our God, we thank you for today. Thank you, Lord, for gathering us here today, this evening. Thank you, Lord, for, you know, your love upon our lives. Thank you, Lord, for this moment that we are in. Thank you for an opportunity to gather at your feet to learn from you. Father, Lord, we pray even as we have gathered, oh God, we pray we hear from you in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, we pray, oh God, that you teach us by yourself in the name of Jesus. I pray, oh God, that these words we hear, you know, they will not just be words we hear for hearing's sake, but you will give us the strength, the grace to be doers of your word in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for answering our prayers. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the living Jesus. This evening, we're going to be looking through the scriptures. We're looking at the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 1, and I'll be reading from, I'll start from verse 11, you know, I'll be reading from the Message version. So he says, "Why this frenzy of sacrifices?" God is asking. "Don't you think I have had my fill of burnt sacrifices, rams and plump grain-fed calves? Don't you think I've had my fill of blood from bulls, lambs, and goats? When you come before me, whoever gave you the idea of acting like this, running here and there, doing this and that, all this sheer commotion in the place provided for worship?" It says, from verse 13, it says, "Quit your worship charades. I can't stand your trivial religious games. Monthly conferences, weekly Sabbaths, special meetings, 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 meetings. I can't stand one more. Meetings for this, meetings for that. I hate them. You have worn me out. I am sick of your religion, 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 while you go right on sinning. When next you put on, or when you put on your next prayer performance, I'll be looking the other way. No matter how long or how loud or how often you pray, I'll not be listening. And do you know why? Because you have been tearing people to pieces, and your hands are bloody. Go home and wash up. Clean up your act. Sweep your lives clean of your evil doings so I don't have to look at them any longer. Say no to wrong. Learn to do good. Work for justice. Help the down and out. Stand up for the homeless. Go to bat for the defenseless." Praise the Lord. You know, if... you know, that just sounds very stressful to read. You know, it just sounds like God is just vexing and he's just, you know, changing it for us, so to speak, that, you know, you just be praying, but he will not listen, this and that. You know, it sounds a lot. And, you know, if we look at, you know, in that scripture, it says that because you have been tearing people to pieces and your hands are bloody, praise the Lord. You know, that's a very, you know, that summarizes why God is saying that he would not be answering those people who pray to him. That's why, you know, God says that, you know, he's sick of the religion, or he's sick of the worship charades, as he calls it. Praise the Lord, you know. And you then wonder, he cannot possibly be talking to people in the church. You know, he cannot be talking about those people who lift up holy hands. How will you be lifting up holy hands and, you know, God would be referring to you as someone that your hands are bloody? You know, imagine being a Christian whose hands are bloody, you know, a bloody-handed Christian. Praise the Lord. You know, maybe we'll just take that as the topic for this evening, you know, bloody-handed Christians. And, you know, it's just a reference to Christians whose hands are bloody. And, you know, I keep saying that it's a reference to Christians because if we look at Isaiah chapter 1, you know, it's basically what God revealed to the prophet Isaiah. And if we look in verse 1, it says that, "This is the vision that Isaiah the son of Amos had regarding Judah and Jerusalem during the times of the kings of Judah, Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah." Praise the Lord. You know, long story short, chapter 1, verse 1 says that these things that are being revealed to the prophet Isaiah, you know,
there are things that God is revealing. First thing is God that is revealing those things, you know. And he's revealing them to not just random people. You know, he's revealing them to the children of, you know, or to the people of Judah and Jerusalem. God's own people. You know, he's not saying it to some, it's not some word he sent to the Amalekites, or like, you know, like he told Jonah to go and tell the people of Nineveh or something like that. You know, he was referring to his own people, the people that he has called, the people that he has chosen, the people that, you know, regard themselves as sons and daughters of Yahweh. And he's talking about the fact that, you know, their hands are bloody. He's talking about the fact that, you know, it's almost like their worship disgusts him. All these sermons upon program upon, you know, weekly service upon first Sunday upon, you know, quarterly program, hourly program, you know, all those things. And God is irritated by them. It's so ridiculous. Praise the Lord. You know, and then we wonder, what does it even mean to say that the hands of a Christian, you know, the hands of a Christian are bloody, such that God will not listen to them? Praise the Lord. You know, and we wonder, is it possible that such a word, you know, could be relevant, or such a word could make sense to apply to us as Christians today? Hallelujah. You know, if we look around, we see that if we look closely, I would encourage us to, you know, in our spare time, look at the book of Isaiah, chapter 1. You know, read the whole chapter. You know, because of time, we would not be able to go through the entirety of that chapter. Praise the Lord. But, you know, if you look at chapter 1, and it talks about from verses 2 all the way to, you know, verse 10. It talks about, it just describes how there's so much chaos in the land. How there's so much suffering, you know, how there's so much, you know, things are just, it's just like, there's so much, you know, that chapter 1 is like, there's so much worship, there's so much church, there's so much religion, yet there's so much godlessness. And not just godlessness in terms of sin, but people are suffering like they have no God. You know, like there's nobody that provides for them, there's nobody that protects them, there's nobody that, you know, that looks after them. People are just, it's just a shameful situation. People are struggling. People are suffering. People are struggling to eat. People are, you know, struggling to do the most basic things. Praise the Lord. And, you know, one of the most popular verses, you know, most popular parts of Isaiah chapter 1, you know, we find it in Isaiah chapter 1, you know, verse 20, you know, where it talks about how if you are willing and you are obedient, you will eat the food, you will eat the food of the land. Or you eat the good of the land, sorry. If you are willing and you are obedient, you will eat the good of the land. You know, here in the Message version, it says, if you willingly obey, you will feast like kings. Praise the Lord. You know, and we like to claim that as our portion. We will eat the good of the land. You know, the blessings in the country are our portion. Praise the Lord. And then he talks again. He says, if you are not willing and obedient, what happens? Isn't the same verse? It says, if you are willful and you are stubborn, it says, you will die like dogs. May we not die like dogs in the name of Jesus. But I'd like to point out that, you know, this saying, this word is not necessarily some word that God is saying to just one specific person. This is what God is saying to the church as a collective. Praise the Lord. To the church as a collective, the church as a group of people. You know, God is talking about how people in the church will die like dogs. It's so ridiculous. But yet, God's words are true. God's words are just. And God's words always come to pass. So we see that people in church are suffering. You know, month upon week upon week, you know, you will see on the internet, you will see on forums, on WhatsApp, people are looking for alternatives to, you know, for tomatoes. People are looking for alternatives to, you know, things that should be barest minimum. And a lot of these people are Christians. Because, for example, if you look at Nigeria, Nigeria is a very Christianized and, you know, Christianized country, so to speak. There's so many churches, especially in this part of the country. You know, you go, you see, you on one road, you can see like, you know, so many churches. So that should be evidence that there is God in the country, that there is God in the nation, and the nation should be prospering. But what? People are suffering. People are struggling to meet basic needs. Some people are dying of hunger, dying like dogs. When they say die like dogs, they are referring to street dogs that have no owner. People are dying of things that, you know, are ridiculous to hear. People are dying of things that, you know, should not be heard of amongst the children of God. Praise the Lord. I want us to look at Isaiah chapter 1 again. I'll be reading from the Passion Translation. You know, I'm starting from verse 11, as I said before. It says, and Yahweh keeps saying, you know, God keeps saying over and over and over again. He says what? Why such countless sacrifices? What use are they to me? You know, I've had my fill of your burnt offerings of rams and your fattened animals. I find no delight in the bulls, the lambs, or goats. When you come before my face, who asked you to come trampling on my courtyards? Stop bringing your meaningless offerings. Your burning incense stinks. Your sin-stained celebrations, your new moon festivals, your Sabbaths, your various pious meetings, I can't stand them. With all my soul, I hate your new moon festivals and your feasts. It's so ridiculous. I don't think I've ever heard of God, you know, refer to something with so much hatred in his heart. You know, it sounds like he's passionately disgusted. He said, they are nothing but a burden that I am sick and tired of carrying. When you stretch out your hands to pray, I will hide my eyes from you. Repeat your prayers all you want, but I will not listen. For your hands are stained with innocent blood. Wash yourselves and make yourselves clean. Remove your evil actions from my sight and stop sinning. You wonder, what does it mean? Like, could it be right that, you know, you say that the collective, the church, you know, that they are sinning. What kind of sin are they sinning that, you know, is causing so much suffering? It's causing God to, it feels like God is turning his eyes. You know, there's a popular saying, you know, something that is very common on social media, you know, which God do not shame Christianity, Jesus, and God do not shame us as Christians. You know, they talk about, they say, for example, you hear the things like pray for Nigeria. And some people talk about how they've been saying pray for Nigeria before they were born. And it's the truth, you know. So, does it not, at some point, do we not stand and sit down and wonder that, wait, though, we've been praying. And it seems like things are not getting better. If you look at it, you know, we talk about how 1,000 can fall at your right hand and 10,000 at your left hand side. You know, and none will come near you. It talks, you know, there's so many testimonies that can be, you know, that we especially in this part of the world, that we like to claim for ourselves, where in the midst of a casting down, you know, we'll say there's a lifting up. You know, everybody can suffer, but me, I will not suffer. Praise the Lord. And that's a sign that, you know, God is real, that, you know, God is a God that answers prayer. That's a sign that God, you know, there can be suffering in the land, but as far as me and my family, nothing touches us. You know, we are good. There's nothing wrong in it. Praise the Lord. And that's the testimony of so many of us, so many Christians. And I dare say to us this evening that is what God is talking about. See, if things are going well for you and things are not going well for your neighbor, who is also a child of God, and your neighbor is suffering, but because you can have 3 square meals, or you can afford this and you can afford that, and there's so much suffering all around, but the suffering is not touching. That's not a good sign as a Christian. You know, in New One U Church, we like to say that, you know, we're a group of youths and young adults that God has called to raise leaders that will influence the world positively. What manner of positive influence can we say we are bringing to the world as Christians, where we are blessed? And, you know, we have Jairus who supplies all our needs, but does not supply the needs of our neighbor. Or that we are safe, you know, and churches, they say, let's thank God for safety that God has given us in Nigeria. And churches have been burnt in other parts of the world or in other parts of the country. The same Christianity. People are being killed like dogs. Not like street dogs. People are dying. People are suffering. But of course, we serve a mighty God. We serve a great God. Hallelujah. You know, so you wonder, what sin am I sinning that is making those people to suffer? You know, what is my crime? What is my, you know, my offense that God is taking it out on other people? Or that it seems like, you know, other people are suffering. And, you know, because the church is wallowing in sin and injustice. But you're wondering, but I did not do anything. If we look at the book of Isaiah chapter 1 from verse 17, it says that you need to, from the Passion Translation, it says, learn what it means to do what is good. Praise the Lord. So in essence, a lot of us Christians have not learned what it means to do what is truly good, what God expects of us, what good is in the sight of God, and not just, you know, in terms of political correctness or in terms of, you know, trying to put up a facade. God is saying, learn what it actually means to do what is good. He says, seek righteousness. Praise the Lord. He says, seek righteousness and justice. Amen. He says, seek righteousness and justice. You know, one of these days, we will talk about what it means, you know, or what the Bible, maybe biblical examples, you know, of, you know, situations where people carried out grave injustices against other people. And, you know, maybe for some reason or the other, God was expecting human beings, you know, presumably his own children, to step in to ensure that justice is served. And justice was not served. We will look through it one of those days and understand what it looks like. You know, the kind of anarchy that blooms, or the kind of anarchy that comes out when justice is not served. But God here tells us to seek righteousness and justice. So because it is not affecting me, because it is far away, you know, let's thank God that at least they did not come to our side. But the fact that it exists should leave a bitter taste in your mouth as a Christian. That's what it means to seek righteousness and justice. You know, the Bible extols us, you know, to love righteousness and hate iniquity. You know, to love righteousness, to love to do good, to love to see it when things are going right, when people are doing the right things. But it also extols us to be angry or to be disgusted or to be, you know, upset when there's iniquity. That's our job as a collective. And that's what God is reminding us this evening. He says, seek righteousness and justice. You know, and it says also, rescue the oppressed. It says, rescue the oppressed. It says, uphold the rights of the fatherless and defend the widow's cause. Praise the Lord. Praise the living Jesus. You know, it's something funny happened on the internet yesterday. I came across the news a bit late, but it had to do with like sexual harassment. And, you know, this person seemed like, or the perpetrator seemed like he was going to get away with it. And, you know, there's this woman on Twitter, and then she stood up and she was like, no, it won't, this person's not going to get away with it. Because, you know, the person's fine was going to be, I think, 5,000 naira. That's the fine for sexual harassment, praise the Lord, in a country where, in a country of Christians, hallelujah. But God will help us, you know. And then this woman said, no, it can't make, that doesn't make sense. You know, someone even said that, you know, he's paying 5,000 naira because he's a repeat offender. So I think when it's your first crime for sexual harassment, your punishment, you know, the sense, what justice looks like is that you pay 2,500 naira. 2,500 naira. If you got 2,500 naira to order food from Childek, you will not say anything sensible to order. Praise the Lord. That's how ridiculous it is. That's what the culture of justice looks like in a country that's filled with Christians like you and I. And this woman said, no, it will not happen. She started looking for people. And she said she's going to find somebody that can actually do something about it. Because why? This person is going to get away with it. It's a repeat of it that he's probably going to continue doing it. And it's even funnier because this person is, you know, in the medical profession or is, you know, working to be a doctor, a gynecologist. Praise the Lord. Praise the living Jesus. But what I'm bringing out from this story is that eventually this man found somebody, you know, in authority in that institution. And then, you know, she said, oh, she was going to do something about it and he will not get away with it. They will make sure that, you know, the justice is served as it should be. And, you know, one thing struck out to me yesterday night, just before I slept. This girl or this woman, this young woman that was fighting the case or pleading the case of other people as a Christian would, was a proud atheist. Praise the Lord. This woman does not, and she publicly and clearly, you know, talks about it, how she does not give a damn about your God and our God. And she has a right to. That's even just by the way. But what I am bringing out of it is that, how does it make sense to our hearing that we hear that, you know, people are fighting for righteousness and people are fighting for justice and people are standing up against things that are going wrong and we cannot find Christians there? Hey, we can't find Christians in their midst. Where we would find Christians is saying, God forbid, it will not be our portion. It will not be your portion. Ah, it won't be my portion. It won't come near my family. That's all we know how to do as Christians. But people are suffering. And us that we claim to be following the footsteps of Jesus Christ, would Jesus not be disgusted at unrighteousness and injustice? Praise the Lord. I pray that our prayers will not irritate God. I pray that we will not open our mouths to pray and God will just look away that it can't be me you are talking to. In the name of Jesus. It says that you should uphold the rights of the fatherless and defend the widow's cause. It does not necessarily have to mean, you know, someone has to be fatherless. Someone has to not have a mother or have a husband. It just, if you look at it, what it means to be fatherless, especially in those times, what it means to be a widow, it just means that there is nobody to stand, you know, to fight for your rights. There's nobody to defend you in times of injustice. There's nobody to provide help. That is what God is calling us to. God is not calling you to come and starch your white shirt and come to church and raise holy hands in one accord and go home and take pictures and say the Lord is good all the time. Today was a beautiful service. We thank the Lord. God is calling you in those times. In times where things are critical, that's where God is calling you. That's what God is calling you to step up to do. So that your worship will actually be acceptable in the sight of God. You know, in this part of the world, we are fond to say worship refers to like the slow songs you sing. You know, but your worship is not just what happens in church when the choir is leading. Your worship is what happens on a daily basis. It is your life being offered to God. But what kind of life are you offering to God? Is it a life that is, you know, filled with self-righteousness? I don't steal. I mean, I don't fornicate. I don't drink. I don't smoke. I don't, what else? You know, I'm always moving about. You know, I don't make noise. I don't fight. I'm not arrogant. You know, even when they see me, I'm always like this. I'm always Calvary greetings unto you. You know, I'm always referring to somebody as brethren, my sister, my brother. What happens when there is injustice? That's what God is asking you this evening. It says in verse 18, I'm still reading from Passion Translation. It says, come now and let's deliberate over the next steps to take together. Yahweh promises you over and over, though your sins stain you like scarlet, I will whiten them like bright new falling snow. It says, even though they are deep red like crimson, they will be made white like wool. If you have a willing heart to let me help you, if you will obey me, you will feast on the blessings of an abundant harvest. But if you are stubborn and refuse to obey, the sword will eat you instead. Praise the Lord. You know, the funny thing about systems, you know, and that's why, you know, I can't remember who it was, but there's a common saying, you know, amongst people that maybe I'll term them freedom fighters, so to speak, you know, for lack of a better term. You know, they talk about how if, you know, something along the lines of if my brother is not free, then I'm not free. My brother is, or if these people are still in captivity, then nobody is truly free. You know why? Because one day, the injustice that touches one person over there will one day extend. This is not me trying to scare us, but this is a warning that is real. It will one day extend to you and I. And what will happen that day? That day we'll lift up our voices. Oh my God. I will say that I want to pray to God to save us. Is it the same God that is looking away? Is it the same God that is already disgusted at us? That you want to answer prayers? And you know why it's funny? In this moment, I just realized that, you know, some of us are even just living life on autopilot, so to speak. You know, things are going well for us, so we don't have a reason to believe that, you know, God has turned his back against us. You know, in church, Sister Peace makes reference to, you know, some people that their spiritual life or their life is just, you know, likened to a fan, a ceiling fan that is rolling. Now, when you turn off the light, or when NEPA takes light, or you turn off the fan, it keeps rolling. That's how some of us are. NEPA is taking light, but your fan is still rolling. So you think that there is light. God will help us in Jesus' name. As we close, you know, the Bible lets us understand in verse 19. And that's where I want us to start from. The beginning, you know, the first part of 19. It says, if you have a willing heart to let me help you. If you have a willing heart to let me help you. The first part of verse 18 says, come now, let's deliberate over the next steps to take together. The first part of verse 19 says, if you have a willing heart to let me help you. God is telling us this evening that he has been seeing also all the ways we look away and pretend like everything is fine, or we pretend like we don't see the wickedness, or we pretend like we don't see when people, you know, and it starts from the small things. You know, it's very easy to look at it and think that, oh my God, this is so political. And so, but it starts from the little things in the house, in the households, in the family, in your schools, on your WhatsApp group chats, in your churches. In times of injustice, in times where, you know, there's so much wrong going on, and people are being affected and nobody's pleading their cause. What are you, a child of God, that has been saved and that believes he is sanctified and righteous? What are you doing about it? But God is telling you that that can be in the past. All that can be in the past. You know, you can make a U-turn this evening and you can turn your life around. You can change things. You can effect a small change in that WhatsApp group that will effect a bigger change, or a less, you know, a little bit bigger change in some other WhatsApp group that will start to change the mindset of people. Somebody will remember. He will see something bad. He will see something, you know, someone being maltreated. He will see somebody being, someone being mistreated, so to speak. And he will remember that there was somebody one day that fought his cause for him, you know, that fought for him, that defended him. So, I mean, people defend, why can't I defend others? That's how a ripple effect starts. You, in your small space, can start that chain reaction that will turn things around, that will make people's eyes be open to see that there's so much injustice in this thing. In the small things, there should not be injustice. In the big things, there should not be injustice. But if you cannot fight for justice in the small things, you will definitely not do anything about injustice in big places. Praise the Lord. So God is reminding us this evening that if you have a willing heart to let me help you, you know, God is ever ready. You know, he will turn his back, but once he sees that you're ready, he will turn forward to you. It's not a wicked God. So I want us to bow our heads this evening. Let's just say a word of prayer. You say, Father, Lord, I look back upon my life. I look back at instances where I have seen injustice. I have seen unrighteousness be the order of the day. And in those moments, I looked away or I ignored it. And I said, you know, what can I do? Or I said, you know, that's just how it is. It is what it is. But I understand this evening that that is not your plan for my life. I understand this evening that it angers you when I look away, when evil is going on. I understand this evening that you are upset, you hate it when I see people being, you know, maltreated and I pretend like it's all right or I act like there's nothing I can do about it. And I come to you humbly this evening to say, Lord, I am sorry. Lord, I am sorry for the ways in which I have offended you by looking away, by saying it does not concern me, by saying it's not my problem. Father, please forgive me. Please forgive me. And I am promising you today that henceforth I will look to you in every situation of injustice, in every situation where there is unrighteousness. I will look for you, I will look to you for guidance. And when you tell me what to do, when you show me the way, I will not look away from it. I will not pretend. I will not unlook. I will begin to fight for the helpless. I will begin to fight for justice. I will know what it means to do right according to your word. And I will not neglect it. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Our Father and our God, we thank you for today. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for reminding us of the importance of, you know, fighting for the helpless, of the importance of learning to fight for what is right, even when, you know, even when we are not going to be the direct beneficiaries of that fight. Lord, we say thank you. Father, Lord, we pray that these words we've heard today, it will not go into one ear and come out at the other ear. In the name of Jesus, we pray, oh God, that you will help us to stand up for what is right, for what is just, for what is good, according to your will, in the name of Jesus. And we pray, oh God, as a collective, we will eat the good of the land, in the name of Jesus. We pray, oh God, that it will be far from us where a few people will be doing well and so many other people will be suffering, in the name of Jesus. We pray, oh God, that that righteousness that exalts a nation will be our portion. You would help us to fight for it. You will help us to, you know, to work for it in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for answering our prayers. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. It's time for us to give our offerings. The account number is being displayed on the screen right now. So please, you know, make a transfer to the church account number. As God will, you know, as God has put in your heart. Please, when you're making your you know, your offerings, kindly put in the right narration. If you're paying an offering, if you're paying a tithe, if you're paying, you know, a Thanksgiving offering, if you're giving a pledge, you know, just kindly put in the narration to, you know, to help for easy remittance. And, you know, God will bless you in the name of Jesus. My Father and our God, we've come to you today, the token of our love and appreciation. Father, we pray you accept us and you accept our offerings in the name of Jesus. Even as we have given, we will continually be givers in the name of Jesus. We will know no lack in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, Lord, even as we depart, we pray your presence will continually be with us in the name of Jesus. We pray that your Holy Spirit will continually remind us to do what is right, to do what is good, to do what is just in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for answering our prayers. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Let's share the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. See you on Sunday. God bless you.
This is New Wine Youth Church, a community of God-loving adults with a mandate to raise leaders that will influence the world positively. We meet every Sunday in church at 8:30 a.m. and online on Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. Thank you for tuning in today. Please remember that it's not enough to just listen to God's word. The blessings come from being a doer of the word. We hope to have you worship with us on Sunday morning. God bless you.